Welcome back to the channel, friends. Today we are doing something different. We aren't just talking about raising chickens. Today we are stopping to analyze one of the most fascinating, complex, and misunderstood pillars of modern poultry, the genetic engineering behind creating commercial hybrids right in our own backyard. We often get hundreds of surface-level questions, but yesterday, a subscriber named Mike, he posted a comment that stopped me in my tracks. It was one of those questions that cuts straight to the core of genetics. I am sure 90% of you have the same doubt, but few know how to ask it correctly because it requires understanding what is really going on under the hood of a bird. Mike essentially asked two crucial things for any homesteader wanting to turn professional. First, about creating the famous red sex link, like the Isa Brown, which exact Rhode Island red line should I use? The mass production strain used by factory farms, or the mahogany heritage type closer to the original? And which hen do I cross him with exactly? And second, about creating the legendary Black Star or Black Sex Link, which Plymouth Rock line gives real results? The Thompson line with the fine, pretty barring, or the classic production barred rock? Friends, this confusion is totally legitimate, and it is the root of many failures. There is a widespread misconception that a breed is a universal constant. People think a bird with Rhode Island red papers is genetically the same in New York, Texas, or California, just because they are in the same country. But the biological reality is that they are distinct populations. Why? Because genetic isolation changes everything. A hatchery in the Midwest might have spent 20 years breeding only for high egg count, while a master breeder in the South focused purely on heat tolerance and dark feathers. After decades of different selection goals, their DNA has drifted apart. They share the same name on the paper, but they no longer share the same engine under the hood. Today we are going to technically break down what happens when you use a production strain versus a heritage line. We are going to discover that, even if the breed name is the same in the books, the biological engine they carry inside is completely different. If you have ever wondered why your homemade hybrid doesn't lay as many eggs as the one you buy from the hatchery, why your birds eat twice as much feed, or why they burn out early, this is the masterclass you have been waiting for. Sit down, take notes, because we are diving deep into the real science of genetic ingredients. To answer Mike's first question about how to build a red sex link at home that actually works, we first must dissect the father of the equation, the Rhode Island Red Rooster. In previous videos, we have talked at length about the heritage line, also known as the exhibition type. You know how to identify him. He is that majestic animal, deep mahogany color, almost chocolate, brick-shaped, heavy and calm. We know from experience and the standard that he is an excellent dual-purpose bird that lays an average of 200 to 250 eggs a year. He is a noble animal. But today I want to introduce you to the other side of the coin, the one almost nobody explains in detail because it lacks glamour but overflows in efficiency, the production strain. Starting in the 1940s, with the boom of the industrial food system, big hatcheries took the original Rhode Island Red and stopped selecting for pretty color, tail shape, or chest width. They focused obsessively, generation after generation, on a single metric, feed-to-egg conversion efficiency. The result, after 80 years of selection, is a drastically different animal, and it is vital you know how to spot it. 1. Color and plumage. By losing the selection for dark pigmentation, the plumage diluted. We no longer see that rich mahogany. We see a much lighter red, sometimes almost orange, or a washed-out brick color. Also, they usually have thinner feather density. This isn't a defect or a disease. It is a forced evolutionary adaptation to dissipate heat better in high-density barns. 2. Structure and weight. It is a much lighter, leaner, and aerodynamic animal. They lost that heavy muscle mass of the original to reduce maintenance energy costs. Everything the bird eats goes into egg production, not into maintaining pounds of muscle on the breast. 3. The engine. Here is the key to the business. While the heritage line gives us up to 250 eggs, this production strain has been genetically tuned to hit numbers of 280 to 290 eggs per year in optimal conditions. It is a metabolic machine designed never to stop. 4. Temperament. They tend to be much more active, alert, and have an accelerated metabolism. They are more nervous and flighty because their endocrine system is always running at max RPMs. So, answering Mike's baseline question, both animals are called Rhode Island Reds. But biologically, one is a tractor designed to last and work hard, and the other is a Formula One car designed to run at maximum speed. Your choice here will define the hardiness and productivity of your future hens. Now that we know the father and his variants, let's go to the mother. To create the red sex link, like the Isa Brown or Cinnamon Queen, we mandatorily need a hen that carries the dominant silver gene. And this is where the key breed that many ignore comes in, the Rhode Island White. I want to clarify something very important because I see this mistake all the time in the comments. The Rhode Island White is not the same thing as a white leghorn or a white rock. Many people try to make crosses with leghorns and fail miserably at sexing. Why? Because the Rhode Island white possesses the dominant sex-linked silver gene, which is the secret ingredient that allows the magic of differentiating males and females at hatch. When you cross our red rooster, who carries the gold gene, with the Rhode Island white hen, who carries the silver gene, a wonderful genetic phenomenon occurs. The female daughters inherit the red color from the father, because the mother's silver gene is linked to the sex chromosome that they do not inherit from her. The male sons inherit the dominant white or silver color from the mother. So from day one, you can separate males that will be white or yellow, and females that will be red or buff with 100% accuracy just by looking into the brooder box. But going back to Mike's technical question, how does the choice of ingredients, production or heritage, affect the final hen? Scenario A, the production cross, maximum profitability. If you use the production strain Rhode Island Red Rooster, the lightweight 290-egg bird, with a Rhode Island white hen also selected for productivity. The result, you will get the classic commercial hybrid we all know, a medium to small brown hen, extremely efficient. The behavior, they will be very active hens, excellent foragers but with a more electric temperament. The advantage, you will have very low feed consumption per dozen eggs produced. It is the ideal option if your business is selling eggs by volume, and feed cost is your biggest worry. The cost. These animals burn out faster. Their productive lifespan is intense, but shorter. At 2 years old, production drops sharply, and at the end of the cycle, they have very little meat on their bones to recover any investment. Scenario B, the heritage cross, total resilience. If, on the other hand, you decide to use our heritage Rhode Island Red Rooster, the heavy mahogany one, with the Rhode Island White, the result, you will still have a color-sexable hybrid, yes. The color genetics work the same. But the adult hen will be very different. She will be a much larger, robust, and heavy animal. The difference, her laying rate will be very good. Maybe hovering around 240 or 250 eggs, but she probably won't reach industrial records. The hidden advantage. In exchange for those extra eggs you lose, you gain an armored animal. You will have a hen much more resistant to respiratory diseases, easier to handle, who doesn't fly over your fences, and handles harsh winters better. And a key fact for the family economy, when she finishes laying, you will have a hen with a heavy carcass and good meat for the stew pot, closing the self-sufficiency cycle. Let's move on to Mike's second big question, which is a constant topic of debate, creating the black star or black sex link. For this cross, the formula changes. We need a red rooster crossed with a hen with the Bard factor, the famous Bard Plymouth Rock. Mike mentioned the confusion between the Thompson line and the production Bard or wide Bard type. Let's clarify this with historical precision, because there is a myth that the production Bard is a cheap or bad version, and that is false. The original or production Bard Rock. Many people mistakenly think the wide Bard variety is a lower quality modern commercial invention. Nothing could be further from the truth. This is the foundation breed, the original one developed in the US in the mid-19th century by the pioneers. Its natural characteristic is a wider, more open barring, where black and white mix in a more rustic way. It is not a defect, it is the base genetics of the breed. It is a rustic, strong animal with balanced meat and egg capacity. The modern poultry industry kept using this original variety not because they invented it, but because it is the one that works best. It is the ultimate all-terrain hen, with a solid laying instinct and iron health. The Thompson line, or aesthetic refinement. Later, legendary breeders like E.B. Thompson took that rustic original breed and refined it, looking for visual excellence for poultry shows. They wanted much finer, crisp, and narrow barring, known as Imperial Ringlet. Thus, the Thompson line was born. They are visually stunning animals, looking hand-painted with a fine brush, with much denser and fluffier plumage. But, and here is the detail, by focusing so much on tightening the bars and feather beauty, this line unintentionally sacrificed a bit of the productive rusticity of its original ancestor. Also, they gained a higher tendency for broodiness, meaning wanting to sit on eggs, which is beautiful for raising chicks but stops egg production for months. We arrive at the moment of truth. What happens when you vary the mother ingredients? When you cross the Rhode Island Red Rooster with the Bard Plymouth Rock Hen, you get black chicks. But the sexing magic is on the head. The males are born with a white spot on their heads, and the females are born solid black. Immediate sexing at hatch. Now let's look at the two possible paths depending on the mother you choose. Scenario A, cross with the original production rock, vigor and production. If you cross a Rhode Island Red Rooster, preferably production strain for higher vigor, with the original wide-barred Plymouth Rock mother, the result, here is born the most vigorous and productive black star on the market. The logic, by using the genetics of the original mother, which keeps her rusticity intact, you get daughters with an immune system of iron. The phenotype. They will be black hens with that characteristic gold collar on the neck and chest. They will be machines for laying dark brown eggs and very resistant to adverse weather. It is the perfect balance between hardiness and mass production. This is the hen that pays the bills. Scenario B, cross with the Thompson line, luxury and beauty. If you choose to cross with a fine barred Thompson line mother, the result, you will get an undeniably beautiful black star. They will likely have denser, heavier, and shinier plumage. The productive reality, however, there is a price to pay. By using a mother selected for aesthetics, it is very likely your hybrids won't have that finely tuned laying engine. They will be excellent backyard birds, the prettiest in the neighborhood, and very docile, ideal for families with kids. But don't expect them to compete in egg numbers with the daughters of the original line. Also, they could inherit that tendency to go broody, leaving you without eggs for several months a year. To close this masterclass and finally answer our subscriber Mike's big doubt, the conclusion is clear. There is no bad combination, only different goals. If your goal is pure economic profitability, if your farm depends on selling cartons of eggs to make a living, and you need every gram of feed to turn into profit, you must look for breeders that include the production Rhode Island Red genetics and the rusticity of the original barred Plymouth Rock. You will get hardworking, efficient, and profitable hens. But if your goal is integral family self-sufficiency, if you want to see impressive hens in your yard that live many years, that are noble pets, and that provide a nutritious stew when they stop laying, then look for the heritage lines. Look for that dark mahogany Rhode Island Red Rooster and that Thompson line Plymouth Rock. Your hybrids will be the queens of the yard, admired by everyone. The important thing, breeders, is not to cross blindly. Don't buy just any Red Rooster, expecting to have an egg factory. Now you know that within each breed, there are two parallel worlds, and you hold the key to choose which one to open. I want to thank Mike again for bringing such a technical topic to the table. It is these questions that raise the level of our community and make us better poultry keepers every day. If you have any doubts left about your crosses or an experience using these lines, leave it in the comments. For your success, my friend. Until next time.